So this is video 4. So first one I have posted as video 1, so it will be video 3, so that we do not miss the continuation of performance appraisal. So now we will get to methods of performance appraisal. So under that you have two types, traditional methods and modern methods. So probably maybe we will deal with traditional methods alone today, and then tomorrow we will continue with the modern methods. So when we say, you know, so there are various methods, actually plethora, you know, of methods which is actually used to, you know, check out the performance appraisal. So this may be classified into two broad categories, as I told you, traditional and modern. So we will see what are the various traditional methods. So under that you have first one, confidential report, free form or essay method, third one, straight ranking method, fourth, paired comparison method, forced distribution method, graphic rating scale. And then we will see various examples under that. Then you have checklist method, and then you have, you know, critical incident method, group appraisal method, field review method. So there are about 10 methods which comes under this traditional method. So first one is confidential report. So as you know, okay, confidential is again without the knowledge of the employee, this appraisal will be done and it will be sent to the higher authority. So this is a traditional form of appraisal used in most government organization, and a confidential report, okay, is prepared by the employee's immediate superior. So if you are working in the hospital, your in charge ward nurse will be doing the appraisal for you. For example, it covers a strength and weakness, main achievements, failure, personality and behavior of the employee. It is descriptive appraisal used for performance appraisal. Okay, so we get to see that it is descriptive in the sense it will just describe about you without there is any no checklist, you know, there where you have to put tick. So when we say checklist, okay, the thing which we do for your teaching practice. So you have the criteria and their marks are given. Okay, so here you do not have anything. It's just a descriptive way of informing. Okay, and then use for promotions, transform, okay, so transfers of employees. So mainly we will get to know the strength, weakness, what are their achievements, their failures, where they have to improve their personality, you know, how they are respecting the you know, seniors. All these things will be included but written in a descriptive way. No feedback is provided to the employee. Employee will never know what is happening, being appraised, and therefore its credibility is very low because they are not getting to know. The credibility of this is very low. The method focuses on evaluating rather than developing the employee. So actually it helps only the evaluation. So it does not contribute to the development of the employee. So this is one of the traditional method, and that is the confidential report. Next you have free form or essay method. So when we talk about this method, the evaluator writes a short essay. He writes a short essay about the employee's performance on the basis of overall impression. So many months he has observed you. So based on that, he will be writing a short essay, and then the description is expected to be factual, concrete as possible. Concrete is real. So it is expected to be truthful what he is writing about you or what she is writing about you. An essay can provide a good deal of information about the employee, especially if the evaluator is asked to give example for each one of his judgment. So it becomes effective when he says, okay, if you are saying he is trustworthy, give example. When did he, you know, show this character? So you should be able to write how, during which incident, you know, he proved that he was able to, you know, prove. Okay, so that is very important. And then no feedback is provided. Okay, so confidential report, no feedback is given. Free form also he will be writing, okay, that sorry for the disturbance. Okay, so an essay can provide a good deal. So he will be writing about the various you know, the things about the person. With example, he will be quoted. So what are the drawbacks here? Confidential report, we have seen. Drawback is actually credibility is very low because the employee is not getting an idea of what is happening in the appraisal. Secondly, here free form or essay method. Through essay with example, the you know, superior is writing about a candidate here, okay, about an employee. We'll see what are the drawbacks. It involves bias as evaluation is not. So bias in the sense, now we know that this is written with the overall impression. If he or she are having negative impression, so what happens? They will write based upon that negativity only. Though the person is performing well, based upon their own ideas or prejudices, it can lead to error. Okay, so bias may also arise because rating is in the evaluator's own words. So as I told you, example again, checklist when you have, or example is practice teaching format. So every teacher will know what is expected, right? And we give it to you, so it is open to you also. So based on that, you can train how to do your teaching. So here also we will be able to check with the details, okay, that what he is doing. So if you know, like assess, do the student have knowledge, you know, good introduction was given, how the student has dressed up, are they have subject content mastery. So like this, it is easy, based on that we can evaluate. But if you ask every teacher to write without giving a checklist, then it is a problem because their interpretation may vary and it can lead to errors, okay. The appraisal may be loaded with a flowery language rather than appraisal of actual. So they will use their own language, flowery language. If you like the person, if they like the person, they will tend to, you know, give appraisal, which will be beneficial to the person. There is no common criterion for appraisal. There is no common. So whatever they see, they will write. Each one will give their own, level of understanding report. The quality of appraisal depends on the writing ability of the evaluator rather than an employee performance. So now what happens? It is based upon the person's writing skill and, you know, knowledge of English. Okay, that will again, it will focus more. So if a person is not able to actually tell a person is doing well, if he is not able to express in such a way which will be beneficial to the employee, then again it will cause a big negative effect for the employee. Then you have, it is very time consuming method of appraisal, and then this method may be appropriate for assessing senior executives when the number involved is small. So for everyone, say for your class now, 50 students, if I have to give performance appraisal after 1 month of clinical posting, it is very difficult. I cannot keep writing essay. So if I have checklist, it is very easy. Then quality of appraisal depends upon the writing, which we have seen already, ability of the evaluator rather than on employee performance. One evaluator may be a good essay writer, but the other may not be. So one will be having good knowledge of writing an essay, his vocabulary, his skills of writing, okay, but it might differ. So that can affect. Sixth point, it is not possible to compare two essay appraisal due to variations in their length and contents. Okay, so these are all the drawbacks. Thirdly, straight ranking method. So here what they will do is, in this technique, the evaluator will assign relative rank to all the employee in the same work until doing the same job. So employees are ranked from the best to the poorest on the basis of overall performance. The whole man is compared with the whole man without analyzing performance. A relative position of an employee is reflected. So they will give rank 0 to 10. If there are 10 performers, 0 to 10, so they will say employee A, B, for example, their names, okay, we will put it as A, B, C, D, E. So how well they are performing, to whom we can give first, second, third, like that they will be giving the rank. So this is called as rank, straight ranking method. So based on their performance, to whomever they feel, oh, this person is excellent, give him first rank. Second, okay, he is better, give him second. So like that, they will rank. For instance, if 5 person A, B, C, D and E are to be ranked, the ranking may be as follows. Okay, straight ranking is one of the oldest and simplest method. It is time saving and comparative evaluation technique. So you can compare and give, it is time saving. And we see that it involves bias, yes, of course, yes. So if person likes somebody, they want to favor them. It involves bias and snap judgment because appraisal is not based on specifically defined measures of job related performance. Then ranking of individuals are varying. Behavior pattern or traits is difficult, especially when a large number of person are to be assessed. And then the method, when you have a large number of people, 100, then it becomes very difficult to give the ranking. The method only indicates how a person stands in relation to others in the group. It does not tell how much better or worse he is than the other. So it sometimes it can fail to compare, in all the aspects. Okay, so no comparison can be done. So this is the third method. Fourth, we will move on to paired comparison method. So this is a method, modified form of man-to-man ranking. So here they will compare and give. In this, each employee is compared with all other in pairs at one time. So what they will do, they will compare with everybody and they will give the rank. Okay, so you can see in the picture that is given here, diagram, comparison is made on the basis of overall performance. So based on their overall performance, they will be checking it out, they will be doing the comparison. The number of comparisons to be made can be decided on the basis of the following formula, that is capital N in the bracket, capital N minus 1 divided by 2, where N is the number of persons to be compared. So the method is illustrated below. So they have given all the employees A, B, C, D, E like this, okay, as a row, as you know, in the table you can see, and then again A, B, C. So A will be compared with B. Okay, so if there is marks, they will give plus. If they are not better than the other person, they will just put, you know, nil. Okay, so here in first diagram, you see, you know, how much of plus they get. Based on that, they will be ranked. Okay, so if they get more plus, so that person will be considered as first rank. Okay, so for example, here in the diagram, C, if you see, has received 4 plus. So he has got first rank. Okay, why? Because when they have compared C with B, actually C is better. So they have given him plus. And when C has been compared again further, okay, then again he has received plus. With E again, he has received plus. So based on more plus, with comparison with each other, when plus becomes more, that person will be, you know, awarded with first or second or third or fourth. Here E has not got any positive points when he or she has been compared. Okay, so for C there is a mistake. When they have compared with C itself, they have given plus. So it should be hyphen, and with D it should be plus. Okay, I have corrected that in the diagram. Okay, so E, when you see, when compared to B is not better, C no, D no, E also no. So there is nothing that he has positive. So he has been given fifth rank. Okay, so that is the example. And then you have a formula also where you can use. N is actually 5, then 5 minus 1 divided by 2. But better is the tabular column, which gives you a better idea. Okay, so here in this paired comparison, they compare with other person and then they will get the, you know, ranking. So here in plus positive sign implies the employee is considered better, and minus sign or hyphen, okay, means worse than the other employee in the pair. C gets the highest number of plus signs, therefore his rank is highest, and so on. Paired comparison method is easier and simpler. This is actually better than the ranking method. Okay, so drawbacks, it is subjective because appraisal is not based on specific job related performance. Okay, so specific for a job, we cannot do this. So that is a drawback. Second, it becomes very large, cumbersome when the number of employees. If you have too many people, comparison becomes chaos. It can lead to errors. Then forced, okay, so these two are the drawbacks under paired comparison method. I hope you're understanding. Traditional method, we have seen first confidential report, how they write descriptively. Free form, essay is written. Then third, straight ranking method. Okay, and paired comparison method, how they compare with each other. Remember to write the diagram. Okay, so next we will go to forced distribution method. We will see what it is. In this technique, the rater is required to distribute his ratings in the form of a normal frequency distribution. The purpose is to eliminate the rater's bias of central tendency. So in the technique, if you see, the rater is required to distribute his ratings in the form. So they will put it as normal frequency, they will put, okay. Then the purpose is to eliminate the rater's bias of central tendency. Here also ranking technique is used. This method is highly simple to understand and easy to apply. It helps to reduce bias involved in straight ranking and comparison. Okay, so here you would have studied in third year, right, the statistics. So they will be using, you know, statistics like frequency, and then so frequency will be number of you can take like plus that they have obtained. Then they will find out the central tendency. So based on the statistical value, you know, they will be ranking them. So that is called as forced distribution method, where they are using statistics and the ranking is done. So when we talk about drawbacks, employees are placed in a certain category and not ranked with a category. This method is based on the questionable assumption that all groups of employees have the same distribution of good and poor performance. So when we say employees are placed in a certain category and they are not ranked within a category, right? So they don't have any category. Based upon this central tendency only they are giving. This method is based on the questionable assumption that all the groups of employees have the same distribution of good and poor performance. So while they are considering good and poor performance, it should be done without any bias. Then Rader does not explain why an employee is placed in a particular category. Okay, so it is not exposed also to the employee why they are based in this type of category. Special job related performance criteria is not used in ratings. The rater may resent the restriction placed on his freedom of choice. Okay, so these are the drawbacks. Next we will go to graphic rating scales. Okay, so it is a numerical scale indicating different degrees of a particular trait. Okay, so we see that there are large number of numerical scales that is used under this graphing system in order to find out their particular trait, and then the rater is given a printed form of each employee to be rated. So these rating scales will be given to the employer or the supervisor to rate the employee. The form containing several characteristics relating to their personality, like exactly how we do for your teaching practice. Okay, it will be help them to understand their personality, their performance, okay, intelligence, quality of work, leadership skills, judgment, etc. All will be recorded in the form. So based on their performance, it will be recorded in the form. Okay, so all this will be printed. What is the required objective? So it becomes easy for the evaluator to evaluate in the form. So are some of these characteristics. Okay, the raters in record his judgment, the numerical points given to an employer added out to find out his own. So they will calculate how many marks, 4, 5, 3, 2, 1, so how much ever it has been rewarded to them, that will be calculated and the performance will be calculated. So rating scales are of two types. So under this rating scale you have two types, that is continuous and discontinuous. Okay, so in continuous scale the degrees of a trait are measured in numbers ranging from 0 to 5, whereas in discrete discontinuous scale, appropriate boxes or squares are used. So for continuous, you have numbers 0 to 5, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So they can give them marks. If they are doing excellently 5, if they are doing somewhere in between 2 or 3, if they are not performing at all, 0 will be awarded. Okay, so and here for discontinuous, you will see that they will have squares or boxes where they will be writing the measurement. Okay, so we will see in detail what is discrete or discontinuous rating scale. So the rating scale method is widely used and it is easy to understand. So this is mostly used because it is easy to understand and it allows a statistical tabulation of scores and a ready comparison of scores among the employee. It is economical to design and administer. So it is very easy to calculate and it can be interpreted. The approach is multidimensional as several significant dimensions of the job can be considered in evaluation. Okay, so we'll see what are the drawback in this also. So the rating is generally arbitrary and subjective because specific job related performance criteria are not considered. So this cannot be considered all the time and that is one of the drawback. It is assumed that each trait is equally important for all the job we require. They should not neglect any of the trait that is required. If they neglect, then it becomes a drawback. The descriptive words used in the rating scale example, dependable, may have different meaning to different rates. So same, if they say, okay, this person's personality is dependable, okay, or not dependable. So if you tick, the meaning can vary from one criteria of assessment to the next criteria of the assessment. There is an implication that I rating on one factor can compensate for low score on the other. So that's what, if it is not explained well in the criteria that is given in the form, then again it can lead to errors. This method imposes a heavy burden on the rater. If the rater is not well trained again how to use it, it becomes a heavy burden on the rater. So he has to evaluate report for performance on several factors, each having 5 degrees. In practice, rating tend to cluster on the high side. A supervisor often tends to rate his subordinates high to avoid criticism for them. To minimize this bias, the rater may be asked to give reasons to justify his rating. Okay, so next we will go to checklist method. Okay, so yeah, so in checklist we will see that this is the seventh one. Okay, so graphical rating you have two types, which is the discrete and the discrete or discontinuous or the continuous one. So under continuous we know that they will give numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and here in discrete they will keep square boxes and you will have to give the rating. So okay, that is a two difference, and overall we have seen what are their drawbacks. So next we will go to checklist method. So checklist is a list of statements that describe the characteristics and performance of employees on the job. The rater checks to indicate if the behavior of an employee is positive or negative to each statement that is there, whether they have a positive attribute or negative attribute. So it is easy to record for them. The performance of an employee is rated on the basis of number of positive check. If they get more of positive, then based on that, you know, the appraisal will be done. So there are three types of checklists that can be used. So when you see that, you have simple checklist and they have given you here yes, no. Okay, so they will ask, is the employee regular on the job? Is the employee respected by subordinates? Either yes or no. This is simple checklist. Okay, second one is you have forced checklist, always regular. So here the options differ, most, least. Always regular, most of the times he is regular. Maybe one or two absentees, but mostly if you see, he is regular. Least, never. Okay, so he is almost late. Okay, to the job. He is taking more of off. Okay, informs in advance or absence delay. Most of the times he informs. Or every time he informs also will come under the category of most. But if he is not doing that, he will get into least. Okay, so like this, you have most or least, which is a forced checklist. So here if you see, weighted checklist in which weights are assigned to different statements to indicate the relative importance. Okay, and thirdly, weighed. Here they have given B and the diag is changed. Okay, so I just change here. Okay, so when we talk about weighted checklist here, they are given the triads that has to be assessed. They have given the weightage, that is a mark, and the performance rating. So weightage is how much you can give. So out of which, how much he has scored. Okay, so that's what is given. So attendance, if you see, again it is incomplete, I'll just mark. If they have given a score of 1, so based on his attendance, he will either, you know, receive 0, okay, scale 1 to 5. Then the weightage actually should be, you know, 5, right? So is the weightage is actually the complete, okay, the whole of the marks. Okay, so here he has received 1 to 5, he has received only, you know, 0.5, okay, very less. So wait, knowledge of the job 1, but how much, you know, will he get from 1 to 5? Okay, if they have given 1, then they have to assess, give 1 or 0.5. okay, like that they have to give the weightage, how much he you know, the total mark, and out of which, you know, what is his scoring, that is performance rating. Okay, so this is the weighted checklist. So here in which weights are assigned to different statements to indicate their relative importance. So if you see in the diagram, there is actually mistakes. Okay, if they say scale 1 to 5, then the weightage also should be 5 for everything. That is, the weightage also should be given 5, right? So there's a mistake, I've just corrected in the pencil. So weightage is 5, so weightage total will be counted, okay? And then you have to measure 1 to 5. So attendance, if he is regular, you can give him 4 or 5. Or if he is irregular, 1, 0.5. So knowledge of the job, how much does he have knowledge? 4, 5, 3. And then quantity of work out of 5. So 1 to 5 you can rate and give. Then the total has to be checked. And it should be compared with the weightage total. Okay, so these are the three types. Okay, so forced checklist, 5 statements are given for each trait, where you have statements like most and least. So with that we should be able to choose. So these are all the types that comes under the checklist method. We will see what are the drawbacks. So it is time consuming and expensive method. It is difficult to assemble, analyze and weigh several statements that probably describe job related behavior and performance. The statement must be interpreted differently by different raters. So different raters use it might change. Trained raters are required. So people should be trained when they are using this. Evaluator should be trained. Next you have critical incident method. Okay, so in this method the supervisor keeps a written record of critical, either good or bad, events and how different employees behave during such events. The rating of an employee depends on his positive or negative behavior during these events. These critical incidents are identified after thorough study of the job and discussed with the staff. For example, a fire, a sudden breakdown of machinery, a serious incident, etc., may be identified as critical incident for the working of a factory. So critical incident will be given and we will have to assess how well they will be able to handle during this critical incident. Okay, so the supervisor will keep a written record, okay, of either good or bad that has already happened. Not that they will create now, whatever has happened already, they will make sure how this person acted during that kind of incident. Okay, so the rating also depends upon the positive and negative behavior that a person showed during this events. For example, it can be like fire, accident that happened in the ward, okay, sudden breakdown of machinery happened, then how did they manage with that, and then serious accident that happened in the hospital, fall of a patient, how did they handle that, okay, maybe identify as critical. Okay, so based on that, critical incident score will be taken. So if you see workers' reaction informed, whether they informed the supervisor immediately, whether they became anxious of loss of output, they became so anxious that they were shocked and they didn't do anything, okay, so that will be checked. Or if they were not anxious, more rating will be given. Okay, then try to repair the machine. Were they able to do that? Complained of poor maintenance early, okay, was happy to get forced test rest, okay. So all this, based on this, they will award them, okay. What are the drawback? Again, it is very time consuming, and for large group it becomes very difficult for assessing for the superior to maintain a written record for each employee during every major event. Then quoting incidents after considerable time lapse may evoke negative emotions from employee. So sometimes, you know, if you tell them the incident, they will become negative. How did you react during this time? Why did you behave? So that will give a negative impact. Then subjective judgment of a supervisor is involved in deciding critical incidents and desirable response to an event. The supervisor, actually, he might also commit error in recording behavior. In chaos time, he wouldn't have noticed. He would have been anxious. So we cannot say that, you know, a short duration event, how he reacted and how what he will be recording. Critical incidents occur infrequently, not always. Continuous record of performance might not be available. So they might not get a record. And then the employees are likely to become concerned with what the supervisor records rather than daily job routine. So what happens when an incident happens also, the employee will be so much tense thinking, oh, how he is going to give appraisal, you know, than focusing on the work. Okay, so that is the 8th one, which is the critical incident score. Next, we'll go to group appraisal method. And this is the 9th method under traditional method. So when you say group itself, I think you'd have got an idea, like group of people or evaluators, they will be assessing the employees. So this group consists of immediate supervisors, okay, like staff nurses, they might have in charge nurses to evaluate other supervisors who have close contact with the employees' work, like supervisors who come, okay, head of the department and personal expert. These people can be involved in assessing one employee. So group of evaluators will be there. Group determines the standards of performance for the job, measures actual performance of an employee, analyzes the cause of poor performance and offers suggestion for improvement in future. So the advantage of this method is that it is simple yet more thorough. Due to multiple evaluators, personal biases minimized. Okay, so when you have 3-4 evaluators to evaluate a person, 5-6, they will not show any partiality, right? Because so many are there. So personal favor won't be there. That is one of the benefit of group appraisal. When we say drawback, it is actually time consuming. It consumes a lot of time. Next, you have 10, field review method. So when we talk about field review method, in this method, a training officer from the personnel department, he will interview the line supervisor to evaluate their respective subordinates. The interviewer prepares in advance the questions to be asked. By answering these questions, a supervisor gives his opinion about the level of performance of his subordinate, the subordinate's work progress, his strength and weakness, promotion potential, etc. So they will see how well you're working in the field, okay? So in this method, a training officer from the personnel department, he will be doing the interview line supervisors and he will be evaluating the respective subordinates. That is mainly the people who are coming under him, okay? So that supervisor will be evaluating. The interviewer prepares, he has to in advance, he has to prepare and he has to keep the questions, what he is going to ask, Okay, by answering these questions, a supervisor gives him opinion about the level of performance of a subordinate. So prepared question he will ask, and to which the subordinate will answer. So accordingly, the reward will be given. Okay, so his strength, his weakness, performance, potential, etc. will be assessed. The evaluator takes detailed notes of the answers, which are then approved by the concerned supervisor. These are then placed in the employer's personal service file. So field review method, mainly, you know, based upon their performance, the supervisor will be evaluating their subordinates. He has to prepare the questions in advance. He should ask them, analyze their performance, you know, their attitude, their knowledge, their skills, their strength and weakness. After he is doing that, he will keep it in the personal file of the employee. So this system relieves the supervisor from the need of filling in appraisal form. So you know what happens, appraisal form, if it is set for yearly once, then it becomes really hectic for the supervisor. So in the field work, whenever a person does, you know, work, and then in there, if he asks him, so this helps him to keep it updated. So he will not have problem at the end. So like how we give session exam for you, 1, 2, 3, then final internals is taken on the average of this 3 performance. So it is done like that. So like this, every now and then when they take it, keep it in the personal file, at the end of the appraisal, they can take it and review. Okay. The ratings are usually classified into 3 categories: outstanding, satisfactory and unsatisfactory. This is, however, a time consuming method. The success of this method depends upon the competence and sincerity of the interviewer. Okay, so yeah, so it also helps. So what happens here, they fill it, okay, the system, okay, no, they will not do it at the end moment. They will also, the supervised personal bias is reduced. Okay, he cannot give his own thinking, because according to the work, it will be maintained. So anybody, even if that supervisor goes, anybody who comes in, they will check their personal file, they will review this, and they will classify mainly outstanding, excellent performance, or okay, satisfactory or unsatisfactory. This, okay, so this is also time consuming, and it also depends upon the competence. Since they should be sincere in maintaining this, and they should be competent to have good questions to ask to the employee. Okay, so it is mainly based upon the interviewer. The traditional methods given above all focus more on the traits of an characteristics, right? In this traditional method, you will see that mainly they are actually checking out the characteristics, the traits of an employee, than on his job performance. In the absence of pre-decided performance criteria on standards, the personal bias or subjectivity of the evaluator affects the ratings. One study of appraisal in General Electric Co. USA revealed that the traditional approach to the performance appraisal caused the following response. The very nature of the appraisal system led to criticism. Criticism exercised a negative impact on goal attainment. So we see, you know, in USA they have revealed that it is not up to the mark, and they have said, you know, very nature of this appraisal system only has been criticized in USA, and then because it has been negatively criticized, it has not led to the goal attainment. Criticism increased antagonism and defensiveness among employees, resulting in inferior performance. So that itself resulted in inferior performance. Praise had little effect, so no much effect. So the traditional system of appraisal are based on knowledge, on judgment role of the supervisor. Mainly it is with the supervisor how he is going to evaluate. In order to overcome these weakness, some new techniques of performance appraisal has been developed. So those are the modern methods to overcome this traditional flaws, or traditional method flaws. So tomorrow we will see with modern methods. So today we have seen traditional method of appraisal. So under that we have seen confidential report, free form or essay method, strength ranking method, paired comparison method. Then you have, you know, fifth one, forced distribution method, where statistical analysis, graphic rating scale. You have continuous, discontinuous, checklist method. Under that, 3 types: simple checklist, weighted checklist, forced choice checklist. Then you have critical incident method, where they will give the critical incident score. Then you have group appraisal method. Then 10th one, field review method. Okay, and their drawbacks you should study. That is the disadvantages. Okay. Please go through the video. Any doubts, please keep it posted.